especially, has good creative juice and good potential to start to make some real differences. And if we're going to have to be on some kind of downward slide in the long term or the short term, this is the place we might make a difference to keep that slide manageable and decent for everybody. So we need to think, remember that. So I like the rub. So, you know, and this is a good place, a good way to remember it. And I like it because it's sort of intimate, you know? It's a good house, you know? It's a nice place to live. That's what we should think about, and what so often we forget in the planning and the large scale stuff is, how do we really want it to be? You know? We want it to be different often than it turns out. And I think the rope really captured it there. So the questions I had, at one point, you know, I went to Smith College, Richard Heinberg was there, gave a talk, and he's a fabulous guy. If you haven't heard him or read his material, I recommend it, because he's probably the most balanced person that can talk about energy and where we're headed without being, you know, if the material's alarming, it's not because he's an alarmist. He moderates it very well. One of the things he said is, you know, everybody can grow a little victory garden. You know, you like those nice tomatoes and whatever, and you get there's some vitamins there. But what's really going to be significant is the calories, growing calories to get through the year. So that's the question I had. You wouldn't believe how hard it was to find people who could give me all the pieces of my question. I called several departments at UMass. I called people at Cornell. I called here and there, and everybody said, great question. I can't give you that part because I can't stray out of my area. I've got to teach in this focus. I'm just too busy. There's no money. There's whatever. So that really, this is a part of this. What I'm doing today is to start to stimulate the questions, because the more people ask for this kind of information, the more likely somebody in some department will actually get funded to do something and look at it, you know, with more precision. And then the follow-up question, which we can talk about at the end, is what would the most productive system look like here, now, and how many people would it support? Because that's where we want to go, on a regional basis. How many people can we support with our agriculture to live a somewhat decent life, and what would that agriculture look like? So, some of you have already been through all of this, the hydrologic cycle. Does anybody need a refresher course? I'm going to give you a little. All of this, without the movement of water, there wouldn't be any life. And, you know, the planet, we're very fortunate that we have the temperature range we do. And as you can see, the thing that drives it, it's good old soul. The sun is the driver. And without the water moving through the system, and being warm enough to be water and not ice, and cool enough to be water and not vapor, that's really important. And the amount of potable, meaning we can drink it safely, fresh water, the amount of fresh water on the planet is in the order of a few percent. So what water we have, most of it's salt water, tied up in ice, and you know, it's not available to us. So the water system is really very, very important. And what happens is the next cycle, again, the sun, takes water and nutrients, and the miracle of photosynthesis adds to the biomass of the planet. So we need the sunlight in the photosynthesis takes the CO2 and the water and makes more complicated molecules, which become our food. And of course, as things die, there's decomposing, they become part of that cycle and the recycling of the nutrients. And most of us don't think enough about the soil. And I had a nice discussion with a retired guy from Extension who says, soil is not a living thing, it can't be healthy. But because he just, no, that's technical. He's having a problem getting over people thinking about it that way. But it is the home of an enormous number of organisms and a huge amount of dead organic matter that was once part of organisms, as well as a lot of the sand and gravel, the stone, mineral parts of what makes up the soil, which also provides some nutrients. So the sun is driving the water cycle, and it's driving the nutrient cycle. Okay. So what happens every year, we have, there's this, the total gain of mass of material that the plants give us is called the net primary production. Without that gain, we ain't going anywhere. So it's a net, there's the definition. The net amount of solar energy converted to plant matter through photosynthesis. You can also think about it, of the interest on solar income. Now, for those who, since financial stuff is big in the news now, you know, you can think about the interest. You should, you know, the rule of thumb is never touch a capital. Don't eat your seed corn. You know, we should live, be working with the interest so that we're always safe. That capital is our safety net. The personal one. That's the old saw. Maybe it's been forgotten or a little bit loosened up for a generation or two, but that's really, there's real practical consideration for that. And when you think about it, don't eat your seed corn, the local history example. Thank you, Teresa, for that. When William Pynchon settled in Springfield in the mid-1600s, early 1600s, like so many times when a bunch of people showed up, there were more people than there was food. Now, Pynchon had developed all these trading networks with Indian people out here. So he sent news up the river and said, we're not going to make it through the winter. We need food. And that was what prompted the great canoe fleet, the corn fleet. And 50 canoes packed to the gills with maize went down the river to Springfield. Think about this. These people here in Deerfield and in Greenfield, the Kentuck folks, are farmers. Farmers don't, if then you didn't go to the store to buy seed, you had to save your own seed. They're farmers. How many years seed do they have to save? Seed, not just to eat. 2 years anyway. These people were trading people. They were often the center of hosting networks of people coming in. Okay, now you got to feed your guests. And they had enough food to think, to send 50 canoes worth like that, right down the river. They didn't hesitate. They were rich. But that's where the value of keeping your seed corn, that's what it means. And that's then the interest, that was interest they were sending down. All right? So next. Now, this HANPP, the NPP is net primary production. All right? Let me quiz it in. The human appropriation is the HA of net primary production. The net primary production has to be shared with every non-plant organism on the planet. Okay? So we certainly can't eat 100%. Use 100%. Right now we're about 30%. And that includes when we pave something, because we're appropriating the ability of that little plot of earth to produce any future interest. All right, so at 30%, we're pushing the limits. Maybe we've pushed it, and I think it's arguable. And I think about my, you know, the peak oil fellow who's not any relative that I know of, but Don Campbell, who when his, and we'll get to his curve in a bit, but somebody said, well, you know, you could be wrong. And he says, of course I'm wrong. The only question is which way and how much? And that's really what we have to think about and remember. So, and here we look at the average per capita, per person, and the per capita thing is the really important thing to remember. Each of us needs a certain amount of energy to survive in terms of food. We use energy for housing and clothing and whatnot. The per capita amount of net primary production that we use in the industrial countries, which would include us, although we're sort of post-industrial, is almost double that of developing nations. So we're definitely on the consumptive side of that one. Something to think about. Here's the map. It's hard to, you know, it's hard to get it clear, but you can see here are the areas where, well, if let's start here. This is the actual tonnage, so to speak. And you can see where the bulk of people live. Is where it's all, you know, that's how much we're taking from the natural interest of the world. And the dark brown is 13.4. Anyway, it's hard. It's weight. It's mass. Here, it's a percentage. And again, you can see what shows up. It's a little different down here, but still, there's, you know, there's not much production in the Arabian Peninsula anywhere because it's so dry. And so it's easy for it to get to a high percentage. Northern Europe, China, you know, India, and right where we are is in the high percentage of as a percentage. And we're using probably, depending on where we live, between 80 and, we're not talking about that, it's 10,000 or something, so no, 40,000. So I'd say 80 and a couple hundred percent of what is grown in the Northeast. So you begin to get a sense of how, where we are according to the margin of supporting ourselves regionally. Next. So I want to make another point here about the humans and the nutrient cycle. I like this one because here's the broken cycle, there's the intact cycle. Well, they talk about, you know, here's the excrete, right? We eat the excrete, compost. We also do something else here, and here's when it's broken, okay? If we don't reprocess what our waste is into the cycle, where does it go? And then we have to supplement the growing with some new chemicals that we manufacture to get the food to grow again. So it's a broken cycle, and we're not in that circle of nutrients in that circle of the water flow. We're broken there. There's one other thing in here that I'll say. So do we fully participate? The answer, no. What do we withhold? Our waste for one thing quite often, but there's other things too. Come on, folks. Get an idea.
Would be dead body.
That's one of them. That's a big one. That's a big one. That's a big one. And I think that's one that we need to really think about carefully. What do we do because we put our bodies, when we're done with them, they get put into things that can, where in situations where they can't again become part of that flow of nutrients. We don't think about it very often. It's not, most people won't consider it a pleasant thought, but it's there it is. I mean, I think it's real. And of course, the withholding by marking off territory for ourselves, a paved world. That's ours. You know, we're withholding that land from the growing green things that would otherwise colonize it in a heartbeat. Leave a parking lot untended for a year or two. Next thing you know, you got weeds, and pretty soon you've got all sorts of stuff in there, right? Because it wants to go there. But we withhold it. We make sure it doesn't get a chance, even though we're not using it all the time. Right. So, the hydrocarbons, okay? We have the hydrocarbons, oil, natural gas, all this stuff. So changing things, we'll talk about the life cycle and all that stuff. Now we're moving into the energy part. The hydrocarbons and the nutrients, the hydrocarbons, it's a one-time only bequest in practice, in terms of what we've got. We've got somebody, our great uncle, left us a zillion dollars, you know? Only we can't ever get interest on it if we took in the same form that we got it. You know, we're not allowed to put it in the bank and invest it to make more of the same. We have to do something else with it, right? So we found hydrocarbons. First, it was coal, then oil, natural gas, and all that stuff. Now, where are we going with it? Next. How we behave. This is like how we behave. We could have done something different. We could still be doing something different with the energy that the hydrocarbons give us. They're useful. They make power. They get us around. We could rethink how we do that so we could make what we have last longer and make a world that's suitable for human life. I'm assuming we kind of care about human life, but make it suitable in the long run for generations to come. The old native thing of seven generations ahead. What we're doing now, do we think about that? And thinking about how we use, you know, our energy instead of this way, conservatively, carefully, might make some sense. So this is the curve that Colin Campbell talked about with the peak oil. So here's kind of where we are, somewhere in here. And we're seeing one of the piece of the evidence. Everybody says, oh, well, prices go up and down. They do. But it used to be that when we have a crisis here or there, the prices weren't so sensitive. The system could absorb those things. The proof of the pudding that we're really at a stretching point is the fact that somebody sneezes and the prices change. It's a little thing can make a big difference now, where it used to take an awful lot. The prices were fairly easy to moderate. Somebody else could come in when somebody got offline. Not so much anymore. Shortages of gasoline in the southeast, I suppose you might have heard about that. There are places where you can't get gas now, all through across the southeast, because the refinery shut down because of the hurricane. This curve is roughly the same angle that Dick Cheney talked about in a speech in 1999 to a bunch of oil people in London. 2-3% decline per year. That's about 2-3% decline per year, I'm told by the mathematics. I'm not that savvy on that. But they both know. I mean, both sides knew it. They came at it from different directions. Colin Campbell was an oil engineer. He'd been at exploration. He'd been in the field a lot and worked inside the company. So, and then he's retired. So now it's like a lot of emeritus professors love it when they get there because then they can say what they really think and how they've distilled what they've done their whole careers. And now they have something to say. And that's where Colin Campbell is in terms of his career. So, so here's basically, when you smooth it out, there's three of these in a row. Here's sort of where we are in the oil. And if you look at the years 1900 there and 2100 year, this little blip is what's in the first half of the century was all about. This is the time when we have built the infrastructure where we now ship food across the country. You can buy organic eggs from California at prices that compete with diamond eggs right here in Wendell. Does that make sense? But that's what that enabled us to do. It enabled us to say, you know, I'm sick of living in my family in my traditional neighborhood. I'm going to bust out and live someplace far away. And so now we're all gotten a little more particular about our feelings with other people. We don't always know how to be with other people when things get uncomfortable because we've managed to avoid it. You jump on something and drive yourself away. Next town, if you want to, next state. So that goes along with the fact that we now have, you know, internet, you know, national trucking systems.
I just can't see the first figure from last year, the dates.
1900, 2100.
Thank you very much.
So that's kind of what's happened next. So this is what happens when you put that curve alongside, there's the smoothed out curves, but alongside the population. And what's really important is on the next slide. That's the per capita availability of energy, oil extraction, oil energy, hydrocarbon energy per person. And notice a peak of the per capita was back around 1980. That means for the energy we have to make sure we are taking care of ourselves globally, each person individually, but in a global context, we each have less and less and less. And as the years go forward, we're going to be on that slide. Now, how long is it going to be that steep? I'm not going to argue that point. Maybe not. But I think it's real sure that we're on some kind of a decline, and that means per person, less per person.
Just oil, though.
That's oil right there, yes. But but the other things are proving not to be very significant in their additions. Yes, they help. Maybe. You do the whole equations, you know, sometimes things don't help as much as you think they do. Some things are, you know, a one-for-one trade or a one-and-a-half-for-one trade. You know, you get one-and-a-half more energy than you put into it to get the ethanol or the oil from tar sands or something like that. It takes so much to put into it and can often be an environmental disaster in the case of tar sands. So, yeah, and one more thing while we're here, so you don't have to go back, but is the peak of per capita grain production was 1985. That's the global cap. So now there's some argument that some of that decline has been because people were doing better and they wanted to eat other things than rice. And that may be true. But I don't think we're going to see, we have much room left to increase the, in significantly in the grain production while the population is still shooting up. All right. Barrier capacity, natural history thing. And I hope with environmental scientists here, I'm not getting too far out of hand. But Maureen Hart wrote a beautiful book. There's a training program for that was actually sponsored by the federal government. Looking for, to help communities find things that would be indicators. What do we look for to see how we're doing that may not be the commonly accepted, oh, you know, the Dow Jones and the gross national product and all that stuff. And one of the things, and in that, she has a definition of carrying capacity. Population that can be supported indefinitely by an ecosystem without destroying the ecosystem. That kind of makes sense. I mean, you know, that's sustainable. That's, you know. So let's go to the next one. So, and here's the other side of that. The community is unsustainable if it consumes resources faster than they can be renewed, produces more waste to natural systems that can process, or relies on distant sources for its basic needs, which is what all that extra hydrocarbon fuel has let us do. And we make stuff, you know, packaging issues. Good Lord, most of that packaging stuff that we throw away is made from oil or gas. Sometimes we make it from gas. So this is the kind of the bind we're getting to. And so the next slide. This is, I love this slide because it's got some kind of humor to it, but it makes the point, I think, very well. You know, this is the population here, okay? So we're you know, all of a sudden we discover oil, and boom, we get to go up to space. And then all of a sudden the oil gets, again, we don't know, is it going to be 5 years that we start seeing major problems? Is it now? Is it 50 years? I don't want to argue that point. I want to say, you know, what's smart to do? How do we behave responsibly? How do we take our part in life to do the to have a good life and also be helpful to life? And I think this thing makes the point very well. This is, we're almost back down to here in terms of, we're on our way down. This is, well, maybe this is closer to where we are, but this is when we're, you know, we're going to begin to feel the real impact of what's going on. And I think we're beginning to see it. I mean, one could argue it all over the place, but I think, again, the sensitivity of the overall systems, the small changes, has gotten so much greater than it used to be. That sensitivity is a sign of how stretched the overall system is, both in terms of money, in terms of fungible energy like oil, and in terms of the economy. So there we go, and the environment too. So next. So when you look at agriculture now, as it is now, where are the hydrocarbons? We're using them in packaging, transportation, fertilizer and heating in greenhouses, pesticides. There's probably a lot more, but I think those count as the biggest users. Transportation, I did some work with a friend of mine who is an accountant for a company that trucks groceries. 80,000 pounds with a trailer full of food. And they consider the fleet average at 5.5 miles a gallon as a standard. That's what the trucking industry looks at. 5.5 miles a gallon. From here, we do better than the national average of 1,500 miles for the food to get to the grocery store. It's about closer to 1,000. Okay, so it's a 2,000-mile round trip. What happens when, at 5.5 miles a gallon, what happens when the price of diesel fuel goes up a nickel or a dime? And when does it become better, easier for those growers to change what they're doing, go out of business, shift to a different market? Those are things that I haven't tried, but I can't answer here. And I've thought about it. I've done some, you know, back of the envelope scratching to think about it. But I can tell you, it's not a happy sight when you think about it. When I did that figure for the people and the calorie needs in Greenfield and the foodstuffs, I figured Greenfield, just the community, the people who live in Greenfield, the equivalent of 5 tractor trailer trucks a day need to be showing up in here to keep the people, keep us fed in town. That's just me. So, you know, when you count the county, it's, you know, you can imagine, it's it gets up there. So, next one. Back to the question, average calories per capita. Okay, that was kind of tough, because you start looking at USDA, and they say, well, who are you? What kind of life are you living? You know, they don't give you a sense to say, how do you aggregate a whole pop? How do you take the aggregate population and say, this is what we need per person? You know, that was tough. And this is where it became difficult to get the information I needed, I wanted to use to process this and make this a really hard science thing. And again, that's why I'm trying to present this, to raise the question, hand it back to, so there's a bunch of us asking the questions instead of just me. How many of those calories should be carbohydrate calories? Now that was a little easier to get. It's somewhere, depending on what I looked at, it got to be 50 to 60%. Some of the USDA things were saying 60%, and then you look at other ones, well, yeah, once again, it was like, what are you trying to do? Who are you? What do you mean? Body types and all these other things. Again, it was hard to get that a number that you could use across a population with or without any other parameters. It was difficult. And then the food sources of carbohydrate calories grown in the region by acreage, by productivity, all that stuff. So I could start to say, okay, in Massachusetts, we grow these things. These things produce so many calories. We have this many people that need so many calories. What's the match? So here's what I stuck. 2,000 calories per capita per day. I think that's a little conservative, actually, especially if we end up having to do more physical work. But I thought fine, but there's also kids. Even though we have a very narrow, the population pyramid is more like a pipe than a pyramid these days, but in this part of the world. But 2,000 calories per day, I said, and I took the USDA 60% from carbohydrates. Now, I don't know about you, but I have a clue everything that gives us carbohydrate calories. You know, I don't know. I do know that we grow a lot. So, potatoes, maize, squash, beans, sweet potatoes, and there's more that we grow up here. So those are the things I looked at. And I said, okay, maybe they're 40%. I don't know. And it was, again, it was very hard to get somebody who could give me that information. In fact, it was impossible. I think I know somebody who might have done this, but in New York State. So here's what I got. In Massachusetts, we have, when I took this from the census and the agricultural census, these are where I, what I did with all, where I got the ag numbers and this, those numbers are a lot easier to get. We have a population of 6.5 million about. We have 518,000 acres, almost 519,000 in farms at that point, possibly less by now, maybe a little more. There's been some interesting changes in the state. Look at the numbers we picked before, the 2,000 calories. This is our demand on an annual basis. This is what we actually produce on an annual basis. In the next slide, I'll show the percentages. In the Northeast, which I counted New York State, 33.5 million people, 11,500 acres in farmland. There's the calorie, the demand, meaning what people need, and then the yield. Next slide. Here's what happens. In the Northeast, if we had to get all of our carbohydrate calories from plants from within the region, in the Northeast, we make 85% of what we need at that 40% level. Again, you know, these are numbers that I'm not 100% sure of, but I tried to be modest about them. I want to raise the question. And if you guys know something better, no, it should be 35 or 32%. I'd love to know that and rerun the numbers. In Massachusetts, I don't think there's any question, even if we reran the numbers at a lower percentage, that we have some trouble in the state if we wanted to depend on our own state. It's fortunate we don't have to right now. But then we get into transportation and the cost of that. So, next. Here's what it worked out by state at that 40% of our calories from those plant carbohydrates as a percent. The only one that we love is Maine. One guy in a big machine at 10 million acres of potatoes is about what it amounts to. this is what it is. And New York is good. New York is a very agricultural state. For all that's got New York City, when you're up, when you go west, it's growing lots of things. And that's a good thing. But you can see where the Vermont's not doing too badly. Probably we could sort of sneak Franklin County into Vermont. But you can see what we're looking at. Do you feel secure?
Did you have any numbers just for Franklin County, which I think would look pretty different?
I did, and I figured, what I remember is the conclusion that what we grow in Franklin County as of using current practice would support about 7,000 people, about a tenth of what we have here. But it's a positive supporting instead of a total drain. Nobody else could come close. No other county in the western part of the state could match the need. At least we had some people still here.
So
here's, you know, I wanted to sort of leave, okay, that's a sobering stuff. This is serious stuff. And because we don't know what the trends are with energy. We know what the trends are in population right now. I'm fairly certain they won't stay the same in population as people are projecting. But you know, we need to be thinking as we look ahead. What can we do? What kind of life can we make for ourselves that is part of an answer, not ignoring it? Because if you ignore it, you can be sure it's going to run over you. Worse, if you fight against it, don't even think about that. So what are the important things? And it's, you know, saving farmland, basically, is the thing. And we've done well in this part of the state with the APR program. But there are other things, and some of it is encouraging cluster development, people moving into town, et cetera. And there's farm energy programs. There's renewable energy programs for renewable energy on the farm. There's things like that can be supported. And if you're farming, you probably want to find out about it. One of the things that bugs me, because working as a planner, we ran into this. Developers and planners love highest and best use, which always means a building and pavement. Something is wrong with that picture. You know, sometimes that might be the highest and best use. The gas station in Northfield we made shut down. That thing had been a gas station for a long time, for like 70 or 80 years. It's like, if there's ever was a place where the soil's turned into, it's like, this is where we should have the gas station. Let's not put another one somewhere else. We got the spot. It's already been nastified. But, fine. But when you have good farmland, is a subdivision smart? Is that the highest and best use? According to today's ways of thinking, and that becomes a technical term when you're looking at assessing property, the highest and best use is always a built environment, if you can possibly do it there. So we have to get on to our planners. We have to challenge it. If you go to a town meeting or a question of property thing, and somebody says, well, you know, the highest and best use for this property is going to be a mall or an apartment complex or something. It's like, wait a minute. Like the apartment complex I lived in when I went to UMass, it was built on what had been one of the best carrot farms in the world. They shipped carrots to Europe. And now it grew apartment buildings and pavement and parking lots. It's sad. It hurts. It didn't have to be. Then, when that happened, it made sense for those people. I'm not going to blame anybody. It made sense. The guys, the family, the kids did not want the farm. But we can not do that in the future. Reconsider educational goals. And if you're here because you've already done that, I mean, most of you who are students are thinking, okay, I want to get something. The environment's important. But, you know, what else do we need to know? And I would say that on your own, or maybe someday it'll be included in a school curriculum, learn some root skills. By which I mean, how do you do things on your own, by hand? You know, learn something. Learn something that makes you happy. You'll have to learn something you don't want to do. But maybe you want to make soap, so learn how to make it. You know, maybe you like to work with leather, so learn how to do things, you know. Add something to your personal inventory of skills and take it to that root level. Because you can have a lot of fun doing it. You become good at something. There's self-esteem, there's pride, you know. Maybe you can even sell some things, you know. But it's But it's also, if we end up having to do more things by hand, then you become able to teach somebody else. And that's part of the fun. I got to tell you, it's not a skill, but my wife and I used to make sure we always had a case of wine at home. And we said, geez, you know, how can we really narrow the footprint of what we get? So we started playing around with, you know, go to Ryan and Casey and pick up different things. When we want regular wine, we get Bully Hill from New York State because we like it and we know it, and we find it reliable and it's easy to remember. But we also discovered the hard cider in West County, and we also discovered a fabulous blueberry wine that comes out of Chester, Mass. So we had some fun doing the exploration, and we ended up with some neat things. I don't see why, whatever you're interested in, you can't find some way to engage in that same kind of thinking. Have some fun. Make the challenges, especially the first challenges that you put in front of yourself, something you're going to have some fun doing. And that helps you to keep your humanity, because if we face all this, we don't keep our humanity, forget it. We're all done. And that's what this is. The social systems are going to change too. And we've got to learn how to be, you know, do more things together. It's going to be, you know, there are going to be times when it's hard and times not. We don't know what it's going to be. But it is, you know, the ways that we spend time together is going to be important. Working together is going to be important. Some of the Indian people I spent time with, there's something written about them in the 1910s when they did their corn husking. Instead of doing all their corn, like I suspect some of us might have done, our family in our barn, your family in your barn, they went through all the barns together as a community. Grannies were there telling stories to the kids, hiding dollar bills in some of the corn for the kids. Maybe the town politics got done, the village politics got done. People had, you know, sang songs, had music. It was a social event, and still the work got done. How can we beat that? So, I think we're there. Next one, Teresa. Ah, yes, we are there. So, here's the thing. We're in for the adventure of a lifetime. And, you know, people have, what is the meaning of life? Boy, do we have meaning now. You know? And we've got an adventure. This is what we need to do. Let's say, hey, how can we get into this adventure? What's my part? And, you know, it's like I say, Pope used to say the real thing. Well, that's it. And real adventures, you know, you're susceptible to real injury. It's not Disneyland, where you're protected, so you don't have a real injury. You have a pseudo-adventure. And that's it. This is a real thing. But I think, you know, we have a lot of juice. We got brains. We still got our bodies. You know, we can function. We got stuff to do. And whether you're young or old, we have a piece to contribute. Elders sometimes have some memories and know how to do some things and know how to be careful of some things that younger people don't know. Younger people often have the energy and the creativity that some of us have let drain away from us as we've gotten older. But the combination is what we need. We need this as a community to think and enjoy that adventure in a community-wide level. So that's it. I'm done.